In just a minute, I'm going to make an announcement telling people to turn off their cell phones. He doesn't want it connected to the service. I'm going to welcome people to JTS. And, okay? So I think we should wait. Sitting. Thank you all for coming and supporting what we hope will be an interesting, fabulous, enjoyable, educational, provocative afternoon of Jewish liturgical music in an a cappella setting. I get to do some rabbi kind of things right now and ask you to please take out your phone and make sure it is on silent, even if you think it already is, because we're recording and we'd like to make sure that we hear the music and not your phones. The second thing you can do to get ready for the service we're about to experience is to open your Siddur Lishalim to page 181, and we'll start in just a few minutes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Father, come in there.
Thank you.
of art and specifically music. She says, art has the power to render sorrow beautiful, make loneliness a shared experience, and transform despair into hope. Only art can take the holler of a returning soldier and turn it into a shared expression of a deep collective experience. Music, like all art, gives pain and our most wrenching emotions, voice, language, and form, so it can be recognized and shared. The magic of the high lonesome sound is the magic of all art, the ability to both capture our pain and deliver us from it at the same time. It's the ability to both capture our pain and deliver us from it at the same time. We're about to sing our way through Musaf, in which at its core are the sacrifices which we once could freely offer, but can no more. Its dissonance in its entirety, a longing for a closeness with the divine presence that we can no longer access. Now it's true that the viscerality of offering a korban no longer exists, but as the psalmist teaches, Adonai karov l'chol korav, that God is close to all who call out, karov like the korban offered in the temple. It sounds so simple, and yet we seem to have forgotten how to call out at all, how to open our mouths in longing and in joy. And so I offer the following prayer, that we might have the courage to open our mouths and our hearts a little bit wider, to call out to the karev in hopes of coming closer to the divine. Adonai, my Lord, my liege, may I have permission to speak of the yud, the hey, the vav, and the hey, that which was, and that which is, and that which forever will be. Oh, to be dreamers once again, oh, how we used to ascend, singing shir hamalot as we rose, in spirit, in anticipation, in holiness, up the steps to where we too could rise like the smoke of the olah, in celebration and in shame and in gratefulness. Oh my Lord, where is the God that was, that came down in a cloud, who walked with us in the garden, who visited Abraham when he was in pain, who blessed and took note of sorrow? Oh my Lord, where is the God that was? Adonai, my Lord, my liege, may I have permission to speak of the yud, the hey, the vav, and the hey, that which was and that which is, and that which forever will be. How I long for the day that will never end, when we'll have achieved litaken, to make you manifest in this world by Yom Ha'u, for on that day, you and your name will be one be'ahava, when your redemption will come through your love and ours, when the nations will come together and sing kadosh, to know that all is connected and a part of the one. Oh, may I have permission to speak of the yud, the hey, the vav, and the hey, of that which was, and that which is, and that which forever will be. Help me to find the God that is in this world and in this me. Open my lips for your praises, and my heart to your graces. Open my lips, l'shonenu rina, for joy and for song, so that once again we may be like dreamers, so that we may offer our words and our time and the very steps we walk on this earth as heartfelt offerings of hearts broken and whole. Guide us towards justice and sustain us through love. Give us courage that we may step out alone. But first, Adonai, open my lips. Help me find the God that is. Continue with Chatzi Kaddish on page 184.
Amen.
Repetition of the Amidah, page 185. Elokei Yaakov, Elokei Sarah.
Shut up. schnell am Nahe.
Razita bo, razita bo.
Oh.
Pajamas, everybody.
Joined us this afternoon. Our vision is that this type of service will be useful in synagogues around the United States. And without your support here today, that can't possibly happen in your communities. The Cantors Assembly has meetings here tomorrow and Tuesday, which is why we chose today for the workshop. So I want to particularly recognize Chazan David Lipp, the president of the Cantors Assembly, sitting over there in the corner being modest. And Chazan Steve Stein, who is sitting in the back in that corner, who is the executive director. Without further ado, we're going to move directly into the workshop portion. Rabbi Jan Erbach is the director of the Block Coker Center for Spiritual Arts here at JTS, and the rabbi of the, what's the official title, Jan? Where are you?
Conservative
Synagogue of the Hamptons, thank you. Chazan Ricky Lippitz is the Chazan at Ohev Shalom Congregation in South Orange, New Jersey, and a huge supporter and proponent of Jewish choral music, both a cappella and non. Maestro Matthew Lazar, who's only listed last because he doesn't have the title rabbi or cantor in this setting. Is the founder and director of the Zamir Choral Foundation. Without Mati, there would be no this. He has supported, nurtured, furthered, innovated Jewish choral music for the past, dare I say, half century.
Not so long.
All three of them I claim as dear friends, and I now turn the floor over to the three of you.
Do a little moving thing, so you can shake your legs.
I'm not going to do it.
Once again, if we could come to order, and if you think your cell phone might have magically turned itself back on, please turn it off.
So I'm Rabbi Janer Beck. I'm happy at this point, if it's okay with all of you, to drop the titles, we're all friends.
Yes.
It's important, I think, that we included them, just so that you know that this really is a joint effort of rabbis and cantors and conductors and all of those who are interested in music and in prayer and who we sometimes perceive as being at odds. Before we go further, I just want to, on behalf of all of us, wish a mazel tov to Nancy Abramson on the birth of her grandson. We also celebrate that with you. So what we're going to be doing now is workshopping the service that we just experienced. And you should know that this is something that we do here at JTS. Rabbinical and cantorial students and sometimes some of our educational students and undergrads and grad students together. And I know from experience that this is not an easy thing to do. Workshopping like this requires a willingness to be vulnerable, to hear that something we've worked on and put our hearts into works in some ways and works less well in others. And so I want to thank you, especially Matt, for opening yourself to this kind of vulnerability. And it's important because I personally think that one of the most important qualities of a prayer leader is a willingness to be publicly vulnerable. It's hard, but it's really at the essence of prayer. And so we do this with our students not only so that they become better prayer leaders, but also so that they have that experience being vulnerable that way. A couple of things that I want to just put on the table before we delve in. One is, like all art, and prayer I believe is an art, it is to some extent a matter of taste. Mm-hmm. We have different aesthetics involved as we approach prayer and different spiritual styles. And our spiritual needs may change from day to day and even from moment to moment. So, we don't want to focus this afternoon on what's, quote, good or not good. It's not really a relevant or helpful question. What we want to focus on is what our goals are in prayer generally, in this particular service, and in particular moments in the service, and to what extent and how those goals were met. I also want to say that when we workshop, and sometimes we think of workshop, we associate that with critique. And critique is not only about saying this could have been better, and this wasn't great, and this, right? Critique is also lifting up, that was fabulous. And here's how and why it was fabulous. Our goal here is to learn not only from what might have been done differently, but what really just worked. How and why it worked. So we're going to be focusing on that. And I know that we have so many experts in the room who will have wonderful insights and ideas and suggestions and a lot to say. In the interest of time, we have about 40 minutes to do this. Rather than just open the floor, we have index cards that we're going to hand out. Who has the index cards? Okay, so if there's a question or a suggestion that you have based on what you just experienced in that wonderful service or anything that we say, just raise your hand, you'll get a card, and if you would pass them up to Nancy, she'll be able to pose those questions to us. So, that said, since our focus is on goals, we thought the best place to start was with the creator of the service. So, Yeshikov, again, Matt. What were you hoping to achieve, and what choices did you make to further those goals?
Thank you, Jan. So when crafting an a cappella service like this, I had three main goals in mind. I really wanted it ideally to be a focused, cohesive, and energetic davening whose parts really spoke to each other, and which allowed, therefore, the messages of liturgy and Torah to lead. So that was whether we're moving and weaving melodies throughout, selecting melodies with fitting intersects, like Yachad Yachad or Lechi Lach, and connecting things that normally would think of, like the drasha and the parsha of the week, to the service, so that we have a couple more, you know, notes in a line to make a melody of, oh, something I'll remember from the service that I'll take with me into the week. So that was number one. Number two, I really wanted to elevate the congregation's religious feeling and connectedness through the use of a cappella group. And in ways, really, that very importantly for me, built consent and trust. I had a lot of experience, and I think some of it's stereotyped and some of it's real, that ensembles that are specialized can feel empowered and yet separate from the kahal, so from the congregation. So it was really important to me to use techniques like having congregational melodies that the a cappella group accompanied, or having them placed in the congregation, having their music memorized, things like this, so that there was acts of identification. There were explicit acts of identification with the kahal as opposed to a separate ensemble, which can, to some people, look more like a concert. For some people, they're more familiar with it, and that doesn't make them think of that. And I also wanted them to be involved with multiple different ways, with spontaneous harmonies, with prepared harmonies, and for some of the specialized repertoire that only they did. So I wanted to elevate the second point was I wanted to elevate the congregational feeling, religious feeling, connectedness. And the third is I wanted to highlight different techniques that you might use when employing an a cappella group in a worship setting, whether it's a synagogue or a hillel. I thought that the service would hang together and have its own integrity as it was, but I also think that people might use, you know, one or two pieces or one or two techniques. Of the techniques that I tried to use were using something different from the Hakafah with the Sefer Torah, using some sort of anthem, which maybe had some English in anthem right before the Chazar HaFashatz, the repetition of the Amidah, trying to use them as Mishorim with a little Chazanis underneath, and some of the other things I've said so far. So that's a lot of what I was trying to achieve in a short period of time.
So maybe we'll, thank you. So maybe we'll, Monty, if you would, just give us a little insight into how you think about prayer, how you approach a service like this, and then some responses to what we experienced.
Thank you. I would quote first Rodgers and Hammerstein by saying, oh, the choir and the congregation can be friends. that is the most important component. I think that when I worked with Jack Michelson, where are you, Dan? He developed a service at TIC, which was truly fantastic, because there was Eastern and Western European chazanis with choir in the background. There was Yismichu b'malchusho with a congregation under my limited direction. We give them a 1-chord, a 4-chord, and a 5-chord, and the congregation felt empowered. They were singing of Demi tunes or Shlomo tunes. Everyone sang, and we would have a great classical arrangement that could be heard in the distance for those who wanted to participate in a Bach chorale kind of harmony. But for the rest of the congregation, they were just singing along and having a great time. And it's, you can't use the word shotgun anymore in public, but it was what we used to call that huge array of possibilities. And no one was foreclosed in their relationship to davening, pardon me, no one was foreclosed in their relationship to the congregation. For me, that was an ideal situation, and we heard a lot of it today. We heard it in straight tunes that were harmonized, sometimes with a little bit of a riff that Joel gave us in the middle of the Kashenim. We heard a beautiful harmony to Erev Shel Shoshanim, which set a different tone. If I were going to ask for something else at the end of that arrangement, I would say maybe instead of syllables at the end of the phrase, at the end of the Yetzirah, you could say Le'ene Kol Chai, and then you have those two fantastic cadences, Kol Chai and then Kol Chai again. Mm. And then you really focus in on those two words besides the harmony. Mm. But I'd like to draw your attention to the various two dialectical opposite components of worship, Tehillah and Tefillah. Tehillah as in praise, which we heard in the Modu at the beginning, and Tefillah, which is really prayer. And that's really, for me, the essence of the two different components of davening. And I don't mean the beginning of the service where you have all these hallelujahs, because everywhere in the middle, you can have either one or the other, or you can have a combination where the music actually is a subterfuge for the actual text. Mm-hmm. So for example, in Simon Sparrow's Sim Shalom, compare that for 10 seconds in your brain with the Janowski Sim Shalom. Mm-hmm. Well, the Janowski Sim Shalom is a bakasha, 100%. Whereas Simon's Sim Shalom is, it's like a fait accompli that God is going to do what we're asking for. And that's a completely different experience. And for me, it's really a matter of your concentration. Is the text being reflected in the music? Is the harmony and the text of the arrangement giving profound catharsis or even inspiration to the performer, if I can use that phrase, and the kaha? And where is it that you find yourself when you're davening? As a mishareir, as a chazan, as a, even a member of the choir, where are you? Are you participating in the imminent experience? Or are you feeling fulfilled by your vision of what the text is and being helped along in a psycho-emotional way by the music?
So I want to just pick up on that last comment, the psycho-emotional. Because when I approach a prayer service, when I think about one that I'm crafting or I'm experiencing, I always think of the overall emotional spiritual arc of the service, of the liturgy itself in the abstract, and of the way that liturgy speaks in a particular moment in time. Because we're always at, I think, you know, remember when you were kids, you did those dioramas of like the solar system, mm-hmm. and all those little things. Jewish time is always I think of it as a line that cuts through maybe 10 different cycles and circles. And so each moment is unique. It's part of, are we in the morning, in the afternoon, is it Shabbat, is it weekday, is it a festival, where are we on the Torah reading cycle, all those things. So there's always, the liturgy is different in each moment. And I always look for a service that if I were a davener who did not understand any of the words, and I remember being that davener, could I close my eyes and listen and get the essence of where the liturgy was taking me? Would I know where I was pleading, where I was in awe, where I was joyful? Would I know that? Some of the things I loved about what happened today, I love the idea of using the human voice sort of like a movie soundtrack. Hmm. To think about the way that a movie soundtrack moves underneath, and sometimes you're conscious of it and sometimes you're not, but it's always impacting how you're experiencing what's happening. And it's highlighting certain things and it's signaling to you, this is a climax, something's happening here. So I think the human voice has great potential to do that. And so there were a few moments, I think, for me personally, there were just some moments when the sound of the harmony in the room was breathtaking. And just speaking about my own personal spirituality, that kind of harmony moves me and connects me to the divine like nothing else. And so that was really just gorgeous. And I will say, I wasn't entirely sure at the time where and why we were emphasizing certain pieces of liturgy. I wasn't 100% sure about the arc of the service. And I will confess, I'm a little bit idiosyncratic in measure of prayer generally, because I like the emphasis on the morning part of the service. The way I daven, I like to linger over Pesukei Dezimra and Shachri, and by the time I get to Musaf, I always feel like I've climbed to the, like I'm on a bicycle and I've worked hard to get to the top, and now I want to just soar down that hill with the wind in my hair and move. Mm-hmm. So for me, this is a more challenging Musaf than it would be my usual. But I wanted to ask you what were you looking for the high points and why? What were you aiming for in terms of the meaning of the liturgy? Where did you want us to go?
wanted to create especially, well, let me say two things. The first thing is that, to be honest, I was trying to work with, from within the 22 arrangements I had, what is going to work for a cohesive, for a cohesive musaf. Within that, I was trying to elevate some aspect of the parsha, but that which had less to do with the pieces, more to do with the moving lefty lock throughout. But the high points I felt were moving to were the Hu Elokeinu, the Hashem Sfatai. I really wanted to build up with between the drasha and just the silence, and to really, you know, give that moment that we're going to open our lips in a completely different way, and we're going to be a different type of kahal today. But I think I might have been thinking a little more emotionally through flow than intellectually through. This is my high point, and it relates to Tikkat HaShabbos and why Tikkat HaShabbos. So I think I related more emotively to the flow than intellectually for this particular service.
It's also important, I'm thinking about something we discussed in preparation for this, that you pointed out that, of course, you, in a typical Shabbos in your shul, would not have put all seven pieces, you know, new into the same musaf. You're serving our needs here to hear new things. Yeah. And so some of what we might have experienced, I think it needs to be said, in terms of the balance or the flow, wasn't, might have been dissonant with that goal of presenting and then letting us experience each of those pieces, because they were special and this was a rare opportunity to hear them done so well.
For sure, and I'll say it was interesting. It was interesting how the a cappella group took up space, because I knew I was going to be in a room with a lot of cantors and rabbis and people who sang, and I was like, okay, they're going to try to push us around and they're going to take the reins, which is what I wanted. I don't know, from the shots perspective, I actually didn't feel like that happened in the same way. It was a little surprising. I don't know if it was because the a cappella group took up space in terms of its harmonies in a different way that didn't allow the kahal to on-ramp at different points. And some they absolutely did, but at some I was a little more surprised at how weighty our leadership was in comparison to where I think everyone's going to sing along here, so we're going to do yachad yachad, and then we'll go into something a little more specific, so a little more specialized.
So there actually was a question from the floor about this, and someone said that they didn't really know when they were supposed to sing and when they were supposed to listen, and were they just supposed to daven? What were they supposed to do?
Yeah. Just like in shul.
So I think it's worth digging in a little bit about how might the use of the group signal that, and I think part of what signals that is a tension between preparation and spontaneity. And one of the things I want to lift up here is to do this well, as you did, requires a tremendous amount of preparation. This involves an investment in a music program. It needs a budget. It needs spending time on this. And that preparation is essential. I think one couldn't do something like this without really investing in it. And one of the things I love about this model, one is that it runs, one of the things I think we want to work against right now is a perception that participation means only singing. Mm-hmm. And that there are moments actually when one can participate really deeply by listening. And so a model like this that creates those opportunities, that this is gorgeous, and I, as a daver in the pews, I want to be at times awed into silence by the beauty of the service. I want to feel like I have absolutely, I wouldn't dare open my mouth and sing right now. I mean, I love singing, I have to sing a lot in the service, but I want those moments where the beauty is such. So this is a model that allows that. And the other thing is that it really highlights the importance of spending time in preparation. At the same time, I think if it feels too prepared, then it can discourage participatory singing.
Absolutely.
And so part of the challenge is to create the feeling that this is spontaneous, even when it's prepared. And I think that's true of all dance. Right, you want to be, because you actually do want to be spontaneous. You want to be able to respond to energy in the moment when you're leading prayer. And so That may be a function here of the complexity of some of the arrangements. And it may be that if the arrangements for prayer purposes are simplified a little bit, and I'm thinking in part about the use of the rhythm, that it creates a feeling that this is a prepared piece that I'm not sure. I noticed that there was more singing when it was gorgeous harmony, but not so much of the rhythmic. And there was less singing along when there was a, so that was just one thought.
Jan just mentioned, I think, the most important component when dealing with congregations and presidents of congregations, which is the people who are the presidents of the congregations have no problem going to symphony orchestras or the opera where they revel in active listening. They would never dare to sing along with anybody, at least not very loudly, and they certainly wouldn't be singing along with the New World Symphony, which they probably know well. But somehow they've lost the ability to understand that active listening in the synagogue is a thing of great meaning and great power, because you can follow your own thoughts as the music continues. This is a very special thing, because most people, when you're performing or you're singing, if you get lost in self-reflection, it's the end, as everyone in this room knows. But the audience, the crowd, has the opportunity to follow their own individual thoughts to places that they never themselves thought they were going to. And another word about preparation, they say that that luck is the residue of good planning. Mm-hmm. And it's very important to be well prepared, which of course I get to my most favorite word, excellence. Because without excellence, it's just haphazard. You know, Toscanini's great line, tradition is just the last bad performance. Well, we grew up with a lot of that. And the most important thing is to be prepared. I think it's possible, once you're really prepared, to be free in the moment and to encourage the freedom of the congregation, but it also helps that the chazan will raise his or her hands to let the congregation know you're in now.
Mm. I have a feeling, Nancy, that maybe after I say this, might be a good time for someone to find out what Amchav is thinking. But I want to get into, I want to say that apropos of Jan, what you observed, yes, there were two kinds of, many kinds of arrangements here, but those of us who are professional musicians know that one of the ways to take a piece that might have felt a little more like a performance because it was so gorgeous and complex might be to take that same arrangement and just start with the melody. And once you get the kahal in there, then subtly get the other stuff going, or start it with a homophonic thing and then get into the polyphonic. I mean, I think there may be techniques to use some of this gorgeous music in this book that we might employ in a living kahal that would help us give that clear message. Yeah, 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 you start that kadashenu, you know, and then we'll do it one extra time at the point that we couldn't stop them from singing.
So I want to amen that. You know, when it comes to the music, you know, in the book, which is on sale for 10% off today, hooray. When it comes to music in the book, I think that it should be modified and used for whatever, to make it work, right? To make it work. It's not set, the thing is, it needs to have that flexibility to be alive in the prayer space. And that, it's interesting, because when you're mentioning about you know, having the harmony come in later, I was just telling my singers, like, whenever we do something that's not a piece, make sure you don't do harmony in the beginning so everyone can get on the train, because otherwise it's going to be like, oh, this got too specialized way too fast. But I had not thought of saying, oh, let me take this arrangement, let me, you know, take my Holy Schneider and take out a lot of harmony in the beginning until I can trust that the kahal has built a sense of consent and with, you know, togetherness, and then we can start weaving in what's in the arrangement. So I say amen to that.
Yeah. One more time about specific techniques. One thing, one opportunity that I think to use a cappella music is to use it sort of in harmony underneath. So I was thinking, for example, this being, so you brought in Lechi Lach, because that's this passage for Shabbat, yesterday was Shabbat Lachlecha. when I think about an arc of the service, in these weeks, I want to emphasize the first bracha of the Amidah. I want to emphasize Magen Avraham. And one possibility that we want of using music like this would be to, instead of having the group sing a piece, simply to sing chords underneath the davening. And hold a, you know, sort of a harmonic drone that would emphasize that bracha in a different kind of way that would still be, you know, that you could do it as straight davening, but to hold that drone. I've also been experimenting with using spoken speech over over singing, quiet singing. And actually, Sam and I have talked about, we decided that probably in this context it was too much, but with, like, the idea of having a chord underneath that beautiful poem. If it would then, and thinking also about expanding the use of the group into transitions, so that instead of a piece ending, it leads to kind of a hum that leads directly into and there's no break. One of the things we talk about in the classroom here, I think silence is incredibly powerful in prayer, and it should always be intentional. Right? That silence is a gap while we're waiting for something to happen, where between loses energy, and the group can so beautifully almost sound like an organ moving from one thing to the next, which would require a little tweaking of the arrangements, but I think could be really powerful in getting that unity that you're aiming, cohesiveness you're aiming for.
So maybe
yes. We're going to take. Okay. I want to say that those of us who have musical instruments as an option, we began by underscoring the English readings with either some guitar cross or piano or whatever. We now underscore all the English. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless not the sermon, but everything else. and because we found it was essential as glue. Mm-hmm. I don't know, working it as a vocal is a little trickier, but those who have the option to keep something going so that we bridge the English back and forth into the Hebrew chant is really, really effective.
Answer. Maybe come do it.
So a lot of the questions, a number of cards came in asking about the use of contrafactive borrowed melodies, particularly the Lechilat, but also Erev Shel Hashanim. And I remember when I first started singing in Zamir with Yomati that one thing you always drilled into our minds was that the text is the important part and the music serves the text. So here we have a situation where we've taken music from a different text and put it into Musaf. So I think some people were maybe not confused, but just had questions about that. I don't know if you want to address that.
I think it's great that Debbie Friedman's music is now Joy Shlomo Kalbach's music, in a way that we can take tunes that were written for a different text and are now used in the ubiquitous way. But I would highlight that with the first great Jewish composer, Salomon Rossi, who was a madrigalist for whom the words meant everything to the music. It was word painting, and that there were editions of Rossi's music, there was a Rossi Maariv service, which is the enemy of Rossi, because the wrong words are to the right music. Mm-hmm. And so you end up losing the whole point of what Rossi was an expert at, and what is, for me, the most important thing about the identity between the text and the music. Because when the text and the music are in agreement, there's no limit to spirituality.
We'll hold on a second. My own response, and I don't worry so much about repurposing music. I do that all the time. I do try to make sure that I'm conscious of the associations that the original melody has for people, and that those are associations I want, and that I do it deliberately. I'd love to get a sense, we said we might do this, to get a sense in the room as to how the use of Lechilah as a kind of leitmotif periodically, did it, for how many people did you feel that really elevated it for me, and I felt it really worked, and I love that. Like it helped me connect to the prayer. And for how many people would you say, day it felt a little distracting or confusing or off or didn't work for some reason.
And there's a, at least a third or a fourth option.
And yeah, I mean, there are other, but even just that dichotomy, it's really interesting to see the room is about split, which tells us how personal this is. And I happen to love the song. I think I would have liked it just as a song. For me, I felt a touch manipulated. And I think we have to be careful about that. It felt a little bit, a little much for me, and I, recognizing also that you were modeling a lot in one place, and that as we talked about. So do you want to speak to that?
No, I do. So I think that one of the things that I would have done differently is I think I you know, growing up in the davening environments that I did, I knew well sort of the allergy to choral elements that some people have. So I wanted, like, how can I create a sense of consent and trust? I want you to sing. So I think I was maybe a little overhanded. I did pick them in places that, for me, you know, Shetaleh Dibusimcha Le'artzenu has a sense to do with place, the Yachad Yachad for Patikat Shabbos felt appropriate to me. And for the transition into Sim Shalom, which is a major, it would function well. But I think that I would have sung, for a service like this, I would have sung a little less in retrospect, because I think I was trying to overprotect myself from a disconnect with the congregation and probably overly relied on congregational singing to bridge that disconnect. Yeah.
Jan, I want to ask you a question.
Sure. Oh, okay.
If you had been told beforehand, and of course you were told beforehand, because we talked about the Parsha, if the congregation had been told beforehand that we were going to be using Lichi Lach, because specifically this is Lech Lecha, would that have changed?
So overall, I'm a big believer in ritual that doesn't need to be explained. Right, that you should speak. If I need to explain it, it's because something's not quite right in the way I'm doing it. If I were going to craft a service that I wanted to bring in, what I might do is do a little Devar Tefila or Devar Torah on Lech Lecha a couple of minutes somewhere. Maybe sing the song once with the original words so people hear it. Uh-huh. And they get it and they understand, oh, that's from what we just read in the Torah, or that's what we're about to read in the Torah. And then if I brought it back as a nigun, or I brought it back as, you know, for something else. I do that a lot. I'll seed it in some way, in the same way that Sam seeded the otherness of Pathet Tiftach with a little Devar Torah, and then when we heard it, it was like, wow, oh, I'm prepared for that, because, so I that's how I think of it. But I think overall, if I have to explain it, I need to work harder at how I'm integrating it. And I think about that as ritual generally, because I want it to work in an unconscious way. I don't want to have to explain, we're about to do this now. But most of the people in the Kahal don't know this song. And I understand exactly what you're saying. And of course, none of us wants to be heavy-handed, but I think that there's a tension that I feel because sometimes it's almost like making a joke and the punchline's not, you know.
Right.
I assume a certain level of knowledge. I'm noticing that all kinds of melodies, I sang Finjan for someone who was about 21, they had no idea what the piece was. So I feel like this is more and more challenging to guess what it is that people, what's the universal melodies other than Shema, you know, that people might know. One of the things that was important to us, and Joel, look, I saw you interestingly nodding your head in many different directions. Joel Kaplan is here, he's one of the arrangers, creators of one of these arrangements, and also is at least the one person I've been about to work with who does this all the time, does a cappella music throughout his service. Are there things that you might want to say about either your own arrangement and or, you know, you're living, breathing, doing this? Is there something you might want to say to those listening about what is effective or what we didn't get a chance to model and you think is really important for people to know if they want to try this genre?
Maybe just two things. One, I'm very, very sorry about something that is in the piece that is one of my arrangements in this book that I shouldn't have put that way, and that is, in Ritze, in the piece that I arrange, the top line says solo. Oh, heavens, it isn't meant to be a solo. It's meant to be the whole kahal singing along. So, Matt, you were singing it with this wonderful choir, and I'm sitting here going, is he doing it all by himself, or are we all supposed to do it with him? And it was the piece I arranged, for crying out loud. So I meant for that to be the whole congregation goes, I know that. I learned that in '06, you know, and that they would all come in. Right. So then the Shaliach Tzibur has to somehow, as Monty said, get your hands up, make it clear somehow that we're all supposed to come in. Because then the balance, and this relates to what Jan said, that was a rhythmically more complex piece for these guys. You only want them to hold back a certain amount, but it only works if either they're shushed and they use a lot of consonants, or if the kahal is singing along and then they can come out and it means that we know what we're singing already and then they can boom out the complex rhythms. One thing was, I'm sorry I wrote that, change it. It's supposed to be the whole congregation singing along. And that could be, by the way, for Simon Spiro's melody in Sim Shalom, Mike Stein's melody in L'Dor V'Dor. A lot of these things I think are supposed to be, hey, everybody sing the melody, and the people who know how to make harmony are going to make harmony, and that'll be nice. And Jan, you made that kind of comment too.
In practical ways that you use this or other things, do you use any of the techniques we thought of earlier? Do you start the kahal without the
yes.
first?
Yes. Yes. May I mention one other thing, though, that's, I think, important. A cappella all over this country, and we need to worry about balance, folks. Ariel, where are you? You sang so wonderfully, I couldn't hear you because you got all these great voices around you. You were doing Adonai Sfatai Tiftach. I didn't know what words you were singing. I couldn't hear them. We've got to think about balance. Thanks.
So a couple other questions. First, a commercial announcement involving Cantor Joel Kaplan. For those of you who are local and would like to hear a different kind of Musaf demonstration on Tuesday, Joel teaches here in the Cantora School, and he is giving a presentation this Tuesday at 10 minutes to 2. It will last no longer than 25 minutes, followed by Mincha here. He's bringing his 12-voice volunteer choir from the synagogue and doing a different, probably not completely foreign to what you heard today, Musaf service. So you're all welcome.
Different version, same idea.
Okay, different version, same idea. Can I throw out something else from the community? This turns it more towards a musical angle, and some of you from the group might have something to say about this. Several people wanted to know about the difficulty of the vocal parts. Can a volunteer choir do these? How do these particular pieces compare in difficulty or complexity to other things in the Ilu Finu volume?
I actually would more like to throw that over to the choir, the a cappella choir, as folks who have experienced various types of arrangements. My sense was that these are, some of them were like Joel's arrangement were more accessible for volunteer choir. Maybe the Sim Shalom would have been, and maybe the Hashem Svatai, but Kilei Olam, I'm not sure about. Is that how would you guys say?
I think the exact opposite.
The exact opposite.
Yeah.
Say more.
I think,
in a weird way for me, the fact that Kilei Olam Pasto, you could sing that rhythmic part, dun, 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 dun. You could literally just sing that the entire time through if you have no idea what's going on, mm-hmm. and it would kind of work.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Willow Kino, if you don't know which chord we're on and which part of the very high melody we're on, it's a little bit jarring.
Yeah, Willow Kino is definitely, that's a Jeremy Broker arrangement, and that's much more sophisticated for sure.
One more question.
I was going to say that then you should just each have a closing comment. So if you want to stop.
I just want to say thank you to my group that rehearsed here in New York and then rehearsed with me for an hour right before. So they did a really great job memorizing and being on point, and I'm really grateful just for all of their time.
Thank you.
to Mr. Corey Hecht, who was a cheer soul and a Sonoran alum as a music director, did a fabulous job. I also want to give a shout out to one of the sponsors today, Cliff and Deborah Hendler of Bethesda, Maryland. They with their kids, started this high school group, Maracayon, which is still at Bethel in Bethesda, Maryland, and they are awesome. And they would come up on Shabbos morning and sing a piece, inspired me to do this book to give them more repertoire to make them, help them to pray and have more context for that. So I'm just really grateful to them, and a shout out to Cliff and to Deborah if you're watching at home.
I want to add another image to this. I, as I listen to this music, which I don't identify as the music of that makes me feel like I'm 20, right? But if it makes my teen choir feel like, you know, if this is a bridge for them into a liturgical experience, I know that even if the average person in the kahal doesn't listen to a cappella all the time, the feeling they would have by hearing, watching faces under 20 singing this would also change the entire experience, because they would get off of the worry about, is it a performance, or, you know, is my choir singing instead of me? And they would just say, you know, oh my God, how did you get that 15-year-old up on the bima? So I think that there are ways, and we don't have to, can't do justice to the question of how do we take something that got us excited today, bring it home, and translate what we want to accomplish in a way that, that doesn't make someone think that we are advertising a performance. So maybe that's because of who's doing it. Maybe that's because we want to say, this is a better way to get the whole congregation to sing, because like some of us use our volunteer choirs, we have people already ready to jump in. Think about how we can bring it home and introduce this genre as something that might not only enhance the listening, but enhance the participation of the congregation, because that's the way we have to frame things so these things can be heard. And maybe if it is, and I don't know if it is, the sound of the under 20 set, is it that sound, even if they don't sing in great Jewish a cappella hazamir like choirs, then that's another interesting thing that has to be that can be explored.
My takeaway from all of this is the balance of the service. If you want to get teenagers interested, you have to give them something that they can participate in. If you want the people who are older members of the congregation who want to sing the tunes that they know, you have to find a way of getting them engaged. Mm-hmm. This is the nitty-gritty, dirty work of programming. In a shul, in a concert hall, giving a little bit to everybody, and where someone, no one walks out saying, I got nothing out of it today. Mm. And this is a tricky balance. But you need to get everyone on the same page. That means the rabbis and the cantors, and I hate to say it again, the shul presidents. Mm-hmm. The leadership of the shul, it's crucial to find a way of getting into that brain and educating them. But the rabbi and the cantor have to do this together. Otherwise, the congregation will suffer.
So I want to pick up on that. Because I think that in addition to the collegiality and the need to work together to do this, and I just want to note that the model we had here was that our darshan addressed his words to the music that the chazan had chosen for Musa. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it works that way and sometimes the other way. And that the chazan chooses melodies because of what the darshan or whoever's teaching the rabbi is going to say. Mm-hmm. And that kind of integrated thinking about teaching and davening and the words and the music takes time and takes relationship. I personally think it's one of the most exciting things that I do, is that kind of creative crafting of a service. And the other thing that I want to say is this process afterwards of thinking through what were our goals and what worked and what might we do differently and what we want to keep speaks to the challenge of liturgical change. And that I think is where the lay leadership comes in. We have to be patient about this. It's very hard to innovate and hit it exactly right the first time. Most of the time we try something, and there are things we would do differently, and it's new for the Kahal, so we have to get used to a new way of doing it, and something that I may hate the first time I hear it, I may love the fifth time I hear it. And so things take time. And that process of evolving the way we think about worship together, first of all, I'm really, really happy to say that that's what we now do here at JTS. We do that. And I think we didn't used to do that, and that's one of the most exciting things about my work here and having a partner like Nancy work with is just amazing. And we do that much more together than we ever used to do. And I hope that this kind of model of not just modeling the service, but thinking about the service and talking about it and what choices did we make will become a model that will help us all to stay creative and stay in a process of evolving the way we think about prayer. So I want to thank everyone for joining us for this wonderful, wonderful day. And thank you especially, Matt, for all of your creativity. Anybody upstairs for questions?
So just before we break, thank you again to all of you for your incredible insights. Thank you to the singers, and particularly to Ariel for modeling for us what quality Jewish music can be in this kind of a setting. I want to quote from Pirkei Avot before we break, and you've been a very patient, attentive, and thought-provoking audience as well. In Pirkei Avot we read, "Make for yourself a teacher, and acquire for yourself a friend, and judge each person favorably." And I think that the field of Jewish choral singing, whether accompanied or a cappella, this could be our motto, that we all teach each other, we all cooperate as friends, and we become stronger and better through that. So thank you for sharing your words with us. There are refreshments downstairs in the lobby. Please feel free to go down. There's some cookies, fruit, a couple of drinks. Bathrooms are on both sides of this room. You should go downstairs, though, this way, either through the elevators or the stairs. Marilyn.
Someone left BMW keys at the security desk.
We're auctioning it off at the general school.
Yeah, I am walking around to see what car opened with them, but yes, if you left your keys there, pick them up at the security desk.
And let's try to make this a 10-minute break so we can come back for the next panel and the performances. Thank you so much.